machine learning. Where do we jump in? So there is a lot of hype around machine learning. I'll be the first one to admit it. Generally, when we talk to advertisers, agencies, they will look at machine learning. It's now become what big data was about 2 or 3 years ago, to say, like, we have a problem. We know where we want to get to. Machine learning is going to be what answers that question, what solves that problem. So we want to probably be practical with the definition of machine learning. So for at least the context today, when we talk about the growth of ML, we're really just talking about how we can teach computers to do something specific without telling it exactly what the process is. So here are a whole bunch of leads that we received. Here are the leads that we know that closed in the past. Can the computer automatically sort out and understand what makes a good lead going forward? Here's the products people buy. If we just show all these purchases to a computer, can it try to understand it? Or one of the better cases would be visual recognition. If we give it a whole list of categorized images, and then an image it hasn't seen before, can it tell us what's in that picture? And we look at successes, can it be done with a high degree of accuracy? So more or less getting computers to answer questions without having to lay out every single rule that would go into the decision the way that we might try to interpret it ourselves.
Yeah. The thing I like about it is that there was a time when you'd run a campaign, and at the end of the campaign, you do a load of analysis, and someone would build a nice predictive model in SPSS and SAS and say, use that next time. And then 12 months later, you do it again, and then you run the model. And there's just too much latency. There's not enough time. And our media is always on now. So the actual ML part of it, we always like to use it as the fact that actually you're doing that analysis not once every 6 months or 12 months. You're doing it every 2 days. And you're getting the optimum efficiencies and improvement over time, because we couldn't employ 100 statisticians to be running those models every single time.
So we can't. And so some of those can even be in real time. Right, so we have some companies that say this example with leads or with image recognition, where they need that answer right away. So somebody comes in, they fill out a lead form. Do you want to send them immediately to a call center for someone to reach them, or is this someone that you want to kick back? But I think the nice thing about it, and the larger takeaway that we try to stress with a lot of the companies we work with, is that it really starts with a business question, right? It's to say, what are you trying to understand from your customers or your business? Not necessarily what technology you're going to use, what software products, but what do you want to solve? And that's generally where the starting point is that you shouldn't think, well, what can I do with ML? It's, what are business questions that you'd like to solve, areas where you think you can make your business more efficient? What would you like to learn? What would you like to have these computers do? And then the second step really is data.
Because we've got too much data now. I mean, if you imagine every time you're looking to DoubleClick or Google Analytics, you've got hundreds of dimensions. You could have more if you want. And then someone says, great, let's make segments of audiences. And you go, yeah, that's an amazing idea. And then someone says, who wants to make them? And someone says, well, how many do we need? And you might say, well, we need 500. And I empathize with anyone who has to try and make that. And it just doesn't really scale. So what we're finding is that one question might be a really good one, which is, give me three discrete types of customers when we're seeing them. And that then is where you could actually apply as a really nice question, which is, categorize users based on the variables that I think are important. And then you can let machines run and figure that out for you. So that the way that marketeer, I think, likes it is the fact that we don't really want to be doing all that hard work. So let's the machines do it for us.
Do you think everyone has good data? People tend to have a lot of data.
Well, I think
how many people here are comfortable with your data quality? A handful of people. I don't see as many enthusiastic people about that.
Let's change the question around and say, how many people who are happy with their floodlight tagging? Still not that many. How many people are happy with their web analytics tracking? And is that clean? Yeah, not many. And so I think that the fundamental thing here is that we never used to have to really worry about it as marketeers. We would accept it from the IT departments that, hey, my tags disappeared. Oh, well, my report's not going to be accurate for the next couple of days. But it'll be all right, because the world will have moved on. And I think that's a fundamental fact that everyone has to get their heads around internally to get your data clean. Because really, if you had a choice of dirty data, but lots and lots of it, or clean data with gaps, you'd actually want to go with the clean data first with the gaps, because the maths can actually make the gap.
Well, that's the thing. So when we talk about building these models, even if you're not embracing ML today, whether it's in 12 months, 24 months, you're going to need to pull on the data that you have. And it's difficult for a machine to look beyond the data you give it to identify issues and problems. There's ways to do it, but generally it will look at the results. It will look at, going back to that example, the successful leads or the way that you tagged images. And that's going to be its source of truth. That's going to be how it understands the world. So if lead information isn't properly filled out, if you haven't closed that loop to say, these are customers we acquired that then closed, it's going to be hard for a machine to then understand what success effectively looks like. So the first part is always thinking about the questions, and then the next part is understanding, well, what data do you have available? And if you're not comfortable with that data, and that data has to be clean, generally it has to be free of biases. So if you've only targeted a particular type of customer and now you're going to be going after a new set, you're going to be going into a new market, you just want to give those a little bit of thought and see how can you start cleaning that data up. Otherwise, some of the results that you're going to get in some of the projects we've run, the answers won't make a lot of sense just because machine learning will be building off of it. In fact, I think the best one was, there was a Twitter joke that went around the other day that said, concerned parent, if all of your friends jumped off a cliff, would you do it too? And that said, machine learning algorithm, yes. It will look at what's been previously done to try to forecast what will happen in the future, but the data set is going to be imperative to that.
The one thing that I'm finding that's tricky that clients are asking to do this is that accessing the data is becoming a lot easier, as we've seen with DoubleClick and Google generally exposing the data. But I'm not sure clients yet are ready to embrace this unless they're working hand in hand with the dev teams and the IT teams and those data engineers. Be curious to know if anyone actually is organized and such, so the marketing department are talking to data engineers and analysts, because you've got to get yourself organized in that way first with the premise that I've got a bunch of questions ready to answer, and then you can go from there. But we're not seeing it yet. We're seeing the visions, and I fear that we have this hype curve coming, and we're at this crest, and everyone's like going, oh yeah, but how do you do it? But we're not seeing that shift yet internally.
What are some bad practices you've seen? Sometimes we learn a lot more from mistakes than the right things.
False positives. So using a predictive model to predict that everybody's going to respond, and then they only target people that respond because they're looking for efficiencies. That gave you great incrementality. I think that's probably the classic one I see. What about you?
There's a list. I'm not going to shame anybody on this. So here would be some of the basics. One is, there's when you talk about accuracy in a model, be careful, especially when you're looking at third parties, as to how those models were built and how they were validated. For accuracy, for instance, when we work in, say, the lead gen space, say only 1% of your leads convert and become customers. Technically, you could build a machine learning model that looks at 100 leads, says that nobody will convert, and you're going to be right 99% of the time. And then you could report that accuracy as being 99% accurate. But you're missing out. So generally, you want to understand dimensions, things besides accuracy, things like the precision and recall of the model that look at the number of positives and false positives. You always want to ask one level deeper to say, well, what are you taking into account from that data? Part of the problem with the hype curve is that we see a lot of people that are saying, well, we built a machine learning model. I saw one the other day that said, we can make food predictions off of answering 5 questions. And I appreciate that you built a model and that you're using math, presumably, to give me a recommendation, but I want to know a little bit more about how you're deriving these results. And then if I'm going to use this model for my business, I want to know how I can validate it on an ongoing basis. So one of the easiest ways to hack a lot of these machine learning models is to take in a lot of your company's historical data and then predict out in a very short timeline what's going to happen next. So we see companies that say, I'm going to take 3 years of data and then I'm going to predict what your ad performance will be just for next week. That's really easy to do. But what I want to see is how far in the future can you go? Can you go 3 months, 6 months, 12 months out? And then also, how little data can I load into this model and still get these good results? So looking at how far out you can predict, and then also how little data you need, will give you a good sense as to how strong that model is. If it's on the opposite side, you're loading in a lot of data, and then getting really short predictions, I'd start asking some questions about how those models were constructed or validated. Were they ever peer-reviewed? Were they published? Do you have different incrementality tests we can run to validate it? Lots of automation, but you always want to know what's going on behind the scenes.
It's a great way of keeping Google's in-market data honest, if you think about it that way, because of course, their models, they have different windows. But if you're actually capturing that audience coming through, it gives you confidence. And for me, as the independent, one thing that I think will help differentiate everybody, if we're all using more unified stacks, so if everybody was here, and even if you had competitors, one thing that's going to differentiate you is the models that you build on your own data that supplement all the ad tech, rather than just picking and choosing different things that are available. And I do think that's the exciting thing that's coming. It's everybody trying to get to grips with the data that differentiates their brand in the category and how you can act on that.
And by the way, those comments I made too, hold us accountable as a company. Any network, if we're going to build things for you using ML, and you want to understand why it should work or how it works, ask those questions. Even with black boxes, we're very careful. Even right now, we start doing predictions around customer lifetime value. To trust us to say, hey, somebody's going to be acquired. You acquired this customer, and we're going to tell you what that revenue is going to look like over the next several years. Ask us about those questions around how we get those models, what we're looking at, what works, what doesn't work. Those are all fair and honest questions instead of simply saying, well, we turned the switch on and it looks to be working. So those are all fair.
And what things are you doing then in the pipeline to try and make this life easier? Because if I were to look around and ask everybody, how many data scientists do you have in your own internal team? Hands up, any more than one? Yeah, no, see, or one, I think. So
maybe even the harder question, how do you hire people for ML? Right? That's hard, even in my home in California. A few things. So one on the training side, we, I think, made 18,000 engineers take a machine learning training course internally. And a couple weeks ago, we actually published that and made it available externally. It starts off just with the very basics of machine learning. Now, we're not even talking code. We're talking about, even if you don't have a programming or computer science background, you can embrace and learn a lot from. I think it's like 6 hours of content, and it's a fantastic way just even to flip through and take the first couple lessons and become fluent in the language of terminology, because it's going to become more and more prevalent. The other thing to watch out for is a... So if we look at this machine learning equation, you're really taking data, you're taking a whole bunch of computing power, and you're taking a whole bunch of machine learning experts to build a machine learning solution. But to your point, we're marketers. How many of us can build these ML models? Can we find people? Can we hire people? And we realized early on that machine learning expertise will become a bottleneck to companies embracing this technology. So what we're building towards is a platform that, it's out in alpha now, it's called AutoML. Which you can kind of guess is what it does, is automatically use machine learning. And so we've changed that equation to say, what if we remove the ML expertise from that equation? What if you didn't need that background, and instead we just replace it with a lot of computing power instead? So for an example, when you're building an ML model, there are features that you can calibrate. But oftentimes in a model, you can have 1,000, 10,000, 20,000 different combinations of features that will all affect how accurate your model is. Now, you want someone that understands machine learning to be able to tell you what features should be included based on their experience and what they think will work. But we just thought, well, if you had a whole bunch of computers, couldn't you run every single model and every possible permutation of that model and then just tell you which one is the best? And that's what AutoML does. So in some cases, it will run 16 to 20,000 different combinations of the model to tell you which one's going to give you the best results. And therefore, you no longer need dedicated machine learning expertise. You should have it, but if you don't have it, basic computer science, basic programming backgrounds, likely skills that are already in-house at your business, can just log in and use the same platform. Okay, should I talk about the visual plugin?
Yeah.
So the first use case, just to make this real, is on the visual side. So we know how to look at pictures and identify what's in those pictures. If we were to go back about 2012, the accuracy on this was about a 25% error rate. We'd misidentify one out of every four pictures. Using machine learning, we've reduced that error rate down to about 3%. And just to give you a sense, if you have people in front of a computer telling you what every picture is, their error rate would be 5%. So we're actually better than human recognition at this point. So we package this up in AutoML, where now instead of having to build your own machine learning models to do this, you can just send a whole collection of pictures that you've tagged, maybe inventory, or some people are collecting posts on social media. And then this machine learning model will tell you exactly for your business what's in that image. And if you haven't tagged the images, there's also even a service where they say, well, we'll send it to the Google teams to manually categorize all your images so that you have your own training data and your own ML model. But you can see the same approach going towards things like recommendation engines, where now you don't have to build them from scratch. You just need to have that data, again, inside your company. And then we'll take care of all the heavy lifting on the machine learning side.
Because it is a bit of a, when you start sitting and looking at these projects, the first thing you go is, oh, that's right, I might only need one person because I just need someone who's really good at math and computer engineering. But the truth is it goes back to that data again. And I'm sure if anyone's running shopping campaigns, how much time you spend in that inventory feed, but having to speak to product team about the photography and all the inefficiencies of the time, we do think that this kind of stuff is going to actually make life easier for everyone. But again, it's tying it back to that use case of efficiency or better predictions. And that's something that's really, it is going to change, but everybody has to get really organized for it. And so I think it's the marrying up of the internal departments of what you're really focusing on. Because to be fair to Neil, the team are like running way quickly and probably trying to solve problems that the marketeers won't need to solve until maybe 2 or 3 years down the line because we can't get our data straight.
Yeah, and that's, I guess the recap is, so first figure out the business strategy that you're trying to address, that you're trying to solve. Don't worry about the technology, the products, the platforms. Just what would you like to be able to predict? What would you like to be able to understand? And how would you plug that into your current processes? Align your culture so that you can actually do this, because it will require collaboration between functions. And then get the data in place. So that way, even if you're not ready to go down this process, you may have other strategies and things you're pursuing. When it does become more important, when these tools like AutoML and from Google and other companies become more accessible, you want to make sure that you're not at that point trying to collect data as to how all your customers and website users behaved. And that should put you into pretty good shape. But you know, I know we're right before lunch, which is strange, and to talk about something like ML, and we've been talking for a few minutes, almost like to open it up for questions, what your thoughts are. And you can tell us that we're crazy, or that you're excited about the stuff as we are. Or just questions as to how it could relate to your business or what you might want to do going forward.
Hey guys, thanks. How do you ensure that certain factors are known that may impact the results? Say you have ad testing going on and then you have on-site testing going on that can impact your machine learning results. How do you ensure that you're taking those into consideration?
So the starting point is generally we look at how the results of the model's behaving. So there's two components to it. First is, in your question, you might have been running tests or something during that time where you're collecting data, which could influence what the machine learning model is seeing. So we will always try to gauge in the training set to be like, how accurate are we at predicting data? So if we have 2 years worth of data, we'll take 1 year of data to calibrate and train the model, and we'll say, how well can it predict the second year? And if we're seeing variations in that, then we'll try to understand what could possibly be causing it. Now, that could be sometimes experimentations. Some seasonality is a big one. So if you only use 6 months of data and you don't capture the holiday season, that causes problems. Other cases, it's to say, we don't have data sets in the model that explain the behavior that we're seeing. So we may observe something, but we don't necessarily know. So word of mouth could be a huge driver for a business. And if you're only looking at website data, you might not capture that that's what's leading that behavior. So you'll see it reflected in the model performance, but then you have to go back and see what's actually causing it. A larger best practice, though, is when companies are running experiments, we generally ask them to document as much as they can about the test, why it was done, how many people it impacted. And that could give us an understanding as to how we could kind of clean up that data in that way. If we don't know and we just see all this volatility, then it's a guess. But documentation around what's happening with business processes is generally the easiest way to do it.
Because yeah. Sometimes you start and you have this grand idea of what this prediction's going to be. And then actually you spend most of your time unpicking the data to find out the things that are really important. And so at that point, you realize, actually, that was a dumb question to try and work out. So then you focus on other things. And it's playing that iterative process rather than just saying, oh, that's good. Today, I'm going to start doing a model, and then tomorrow, I'll run it.
I think, actually, now that we're finishing up, we just finished up with basketball. I think that was a good example. There were a lot of people that use machine learning to try to figure out who the winner would be this year in the NCAA. Those models didn't work very well. You know, I think even there was a time someone was posting a picture, I think like the top leader on ESPN, regardless of all these techniques used, was someone that said, like, I just guessed. That was actually their name that they added. But there were a whole bunch of contests, even internally with Google Cloud, where people were looking at specific attributes to say, if we looked at a game, could we predict how many three-pointers there will be, or free throw percentages? Those aspects of the model turned out to be incredibly accurate. So sometimes even just scaling back the ambitions of what we can try to predict could be helpful. So instead of saying, do we know exactly how much this lead is going to be worth, that might prove difficult in an ML model. But if you scale it back and say, do we think that this lead is going to be better or worse than the average lead that we acquire? And can we prioritize in that way? You might end up with a much better result. So it oftentimes can turn out just to be how you ask that question, and then how you respond if that question is able to be predicted or not.
Thank you so much. Quick question for you about data integrity. For a lot of marketers, it's a real challenge to sort of get past the dirty data. What are the best practices that you're offering to people as they start to venture into machine learning? Because ultimately, it's only as good as the data you put into it.
That's true.
I think that a long-term vision of your data collection methodology is really important. If you're not thinking about it, and say you're working where you'll have a campaign, and you go, I know, I'll set up some new tags just specifically for this campaign. And then 3 months later, you set up some more tags. And then you go, oh, I'm going to build a microsite, and I'm going to set up web analytics, but I'm not going to make it as part of the roll-up. It's those kind of governance processes that are really important to get in place so that actually over time your data gets better and better and better. It's not going to be, it's very difficult to go back and clean up all your data previously. You can try it, but what I know is that there are quite a few advertisers and networks who haven't really been thinking about why they're collecting the data. They've just been collecting data to report on campaign performance. It does need a mind shift to say, I need to capture this data and these variables over the next 3 years, because these are the type of questions I'm going to ask. So, and if you capture it there, you will have a bit of a scorched earth policy for all the stuff that's gone previously, but you get in good shape. But it is about governance and smiling nicely with the devs, with implementing tags in the right way, which is always tricky for some reason.
I like accountability. I love when I say, well, who is responsible? If something's broken in an organization, it's kind of funny because you'll talk to the marketers and say, well, we gave the tags to the dev team. And the dev team will come back and say, well, you didn't give me proper documentation. And they'll wrestle back and forth, or you didn't get it in time for the sprint. I just like to know who's responsible for it. Whose job is it to ensure that the data being collected across, say, just digital assets? Who's responsible? And if something goes wrong, who do we go towards? Otherwise, there seems to be a lack of accountability and just a general feeling in the organization. We don't trust our data, and it's kind of a dance in a partnership, but still, we don't know who's actually going to be held accountable at the end of the day.
And the way we frame it sometimes is there's actually this value to that tag. So whereas before it was reporting, if I was to say to you, if you hadn't got your tags right, it actually cost you an incremental $100,000 in display media, then I think everyone would like start going, oh, hang on a minute. Maybe we should be paying a bit more attention to this because it's just cost us a fortune in PMPs with a publisher that I had to buy, but I didn't realize that was actually our audience since we bought the same audience twice. It's that kind of thing. If you turn it with a monetary number, everybody starts paying attention really quickly, but because media spend comes and goes, and there's always some more next month. No one really ever worries about it, apparently. That's the key thing. That's a good way of twisting around.
And one last thought on this. If you're really struggling with data capture, a lot of companies will look at it, and they'll simply look at how many different systems that they're working with. It's not uncommon now to see marketers that are using 17 or 18 different systems, all with differing degrees of data quality. And CRM systems in particular, when we talk to advertisers, they say, well, we don't trust our CRM data. And it's a huge cleanup project, not to mention an organizational shift to get everybody to enter in all of their CRM data consistently all the time. So oftentimes we'll just try to narrow it down to say, if the CRM data system as a whole is incorrect, are there particular fields or parts of information that we feel good about using? So we know how much money we made. We know the product we sold. We know inventory. So that's data that we can use and we feel good, as opposed to writing off the entire system or platform. So sometimes, like, you can connect Google Analytics and web analytics platforms, and we'll often see breaks where they say, well, we didn't capture everything that happened on this microsite. But do you still feel comfortable about this traffic data? Or if you go into AdWords, do you feel comfortable with the data that it's reporting? And start there, as opposed to just writing off the entire data source and say, well, nobody believes the CRM system. 80% of that data might be incorrect, but if you feel really confident about what's left over and the fields that it's capturing, then at least we can start there. And always keep in mind, I see a lot of people nodding their heads when we talk about data quality issues, even when we ask people to raise their hands. Look around. Other companies are struggling with these same issues. I'm unaware of a perfect company. Even Google, we're vigilant about how we collect data and how we organize that data. This is a common industry problem. So look at it not necessarily to be perfect, which I think is a really hard goal, but just say, how can we be better than the people we're competing against? So if we're all building the same models, or if we're all doing the same targeting, we all have the same tools, if we have slightly better data than our competitors, just because we implemented one more process, or we had one more person responsible for it, then we're likely going to get a slightly better outcome than the people we're competing with. So it's a perpetual problem, but I think any progress is going to be good.
So in a world where we've now got used to using, like, data at the heart of our planning processes and building plans for media execution, which focus around extrapolating first-party data, how would you use AI alongside what we're doing? What's the best way to incorporate this into media execution, for example, in a practical way?
That's an easy one, James. Thanks. One thing is clear is that you need to break it down into bite-sized chunks. You can't build one model to fix your marketing. So you need to organize your marketing in a way which actually allows it to add to part of that. So one might be splitting your media plans into acquisition and customer retention. That makes life a lot easier for you, because in your customer side, you might want to do more meaningful segmentations, which then actually determines how much you might want to spend on certain customers, because you can predict what their lifetime value might be. On the flip side for acquisition, you might be trying to work out how much you might want to bid for somebody. And so in doing that, you'll then take into account the variables that are available there, and doing it piecemeal, bit by bit. I don't think there's a way you can just get it like a big sticker and then slap it on top of your marketing and go, it'll solve it.
Amen. I think that's true. I mean, one of the things that we love to see, and something that we talk about, is brilliant basics. And that always maps back to strong tagging architectures, like a really good infrastructure at the base of what we're doing, so we can build on something which is solid and not that doesn't become a sort of leaning tower of kind of Jenga. So it's nice to see that actually these themes ring true, whether we're talking about just good old-fashioned getting the technology right, getting our ad tech implemented properly, or when it translates through to thinking about some of the future-gazing things that, or some of the possibilities that were going to be arising in the future, it all maps back to the brilliant basics. And having an iterative process around it and taking it in bite-sized pieces, I think that's a really valuable takeaway.